my message is more teaching than preaching. And I'm going to be honest, it's not a fun, flowery message. I said, God, on Mother's Day? Right? On Mother's Day? And actually, there's parts of it that are hard and challenging. But I really believe that it's God's message, okay? So let's just take a moment and pray. Father, I love you and I love your word. And this morning, my desire is to honor your word, to honor you and to honor your word. And I pray, Father, that the eyes of our understanding would be flooded with light, that we could see clearly. I pray that our ears would be opened so that we could hear what you have to say. And Lord, I pray that our hearts also would be open so that we can receive your word. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to be sharing with you this morning what God showed me a few months back. And it was in 2 Kings. And as I was reading, it was one of those, you know, sometimes we say aha moments or wow moments. Well, for me, as I'm reading, I go, oh my gosh. It was just an opening as I read that. And I should have seen it years ago. But it was just an opening. But I'm going to start first by talking to you and giving you some background of what was taking place here in 2 Kings, which we'll get into in just a little bit. And we're going to start with Solomon. We know that God anointed him as king. We know that he gave him wisdom and favor. We know that Solomon loved God. He loved God. He built the temple for God's presence to dwell in. That was when the Shekinah glory came and filled the temple. And it became a place for him and all of Israel to come and to worship God and to bring their sacrifices. He followed God. He kept his commands, and so Israel followed God and kept his commands. But we're going to find that in Solomon's later years, the word said he took many foreign wives, which God had told him, don't do it, don't do it. And because he did, a result was that they, the foreign wives, they turned his heart to worship and to sacrifice other gods, pagan gods, false gods. And so the children of Israel followed Solomon, and they worshiped and they sacrificed to other gods as the leader, as the children here. And so when Solomon died, the kingdom divided. There had become a conflict on kings, and it divided. The northern kingdom became Israel. The southern kingdom was Judah. And it said that all the kings that reigned in Israel, and there were a lot of them, they were evil. And in Judah, they were evil, all the kings except for three. And it said that there were two who followed God and turned the people's hearts. Because they followed God, did what he wanted, it turned the people's hearts back to God. But it said that Hezekiah, who was one of these three, he followed God completely. And he did everything that God told him to do. And he was the last good king. So now we're going to go to 2 Kings 18, 1 through 5, and I'm just going to read off of the screen. Oh, well, I can't read that, so I'll read here. Can't you enlarge that, Sam? You know, it's really strange because I feel funny because I talk with my hands. And I feel like I'm bound up here. Okay. So now it came to pass in the third year of Hoshea, the son of Elah, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. He was 25 years old when he became king, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Abi, the daughter of Zechariah, and he did what was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father David, now David, this would be a great, 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 however many greats grandfathers had done. He removed the high places, and he broke the sacred pillars. He cut down the wooden image, and he broke in pieces the bronze serpent that Moses had made. For until those days, the children of Israel burned incense to it and called it Neshutan, which is serpent. He trusted in the Lord God of Israel, so that after him was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor who were before him. And I want us to just zero in for a minute on verse 4. Those first few lines, let's go back there, yeah. Okay, those first few lines were, oh my God, verses. He removed the high places, he broke the sacred pillars, and he cut down the wooden images. Amen. So the high places, they were places that were built up high in the mountains. They were in places that were hidden and secret. They built altars there, and they worshiped and they sacrificed to those pagan false gods. And as I was reading this, and it became so real to me, it was like I could see Hezekiah climbing up that mountain. I mean, he was out on a mission. And he climbed up the mountain, and he got up there, and he tore down the altars. And he smashed the idols. And I could see this. It was so real to me. And at the same time that I'm seeing this and feeling this, I got all this, I don't know, stuff, all this stuff just floating around in my mind. And I knew God was trying to help me connect with what he was saying, with what was now. You know, Old Testament, New Testament, yesterday, today. What did that took place then have to do with now? And as I was struggling with that, the Holy Spirit brought to my mind 1 Corinthians 10:4. It says, For the weapons of our warfare, we're in a battle. Now, we can choose not to be, but really, we are in a battle. And the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal. They're not natural. A gun's not going to do it. A sword's not going to do it. A fist fight's not going to do it. Our weapons are not natural. But they are mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. Amen? Amen. So let's talk a minute about what is a stronghold. Well, I found two definitions. One was anything or anyone that has power over you. If there's anything or anyone that has power over you, that's a stronghold. And it doesn't have to be something physical. It can be mental. It can be emotional, right? But that's a stronghold. If you find yourself unable to do what you want to do, many times that's a stronghold. And the second one is a resistance in a person's mind against God and his word. A resistance in a person's mind against God and his word. That's a stronghold. So I want to go back to, while we're there, okay? For the weapons of our warfare are not natural, but they're mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. Now we're going to go to 5. Casting down. Now looky, we're pulling down. Am I blowing? We're pulling down strongholds and we're casting down arguments, reasonings, okay? It goes back up here, a resistance in a person's mind, this reasoning against God and his word, casting down arguments or reasonings. And look here again, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, the word of God, and bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So we have pulling down, we have casting down, and we have bringing every thought. That place where a person's mind resists God and his word. So now I want to go to Ephesians 6:12. For we do not wrestle. We don't struggle. We don't fight. And this fight is a fight to the finish. It's a fight to the finish. We don't get to take time out. It's a fight to the finish. So for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but we wrestle, we fight against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age. And this is it. Against spiritual host of wickedness. Where? In the heavenly places. The high places. Spiritual wickedness in the high places. So we find out that strongholds are demonic. They are demonic. And natural weapons have no power against them. They can only be pulled down by God-empowered prayer through the name of Jesus and understanding your authority. Amen. Amen. God, see, we don't have the ability to do that. Or we just don't have it. It says, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. So when we find ourselves in situations and we're trying to fight them in the natural, it's just not going to work. It's not going to work because it takes God-empowered prayer and the Holy Spirit showing us. So God began to show me some areas to pray, and of course, the first one he started with was myself. Begin to ask, Lord, are there areas in my life? Are there strongholds? I need to know. I begin to pray for my family, for my kids, my grandkids, my great-grandkids. I mean, you know, you said generations down, right? So I begin to pray for them, and I actually said to the Holy Spirit, I said, I don't want to guess. See, I don't want to guess what that stronghold is. I don't want to look in the natural and see a quality that I think, whoa, you know? But Holy Spirit, I need you to go to the root and show me what the real stronghold is. Do you know that sometimes when we're praying for some, we think that a certain thing is their problem, and it's not. Amen. There can be a root. Yes. And God wants us to go and find that root. Amen. and pull it down. Amen? And so God did show me some things. He showed me some things in my life, and he showed me some in my other, in my family. And I'm just going to give you a few of them. One was anger. You know, sometimes you think, and I'm not saying that it can't be, please, but sometimes we focus on drugs, or we focus on alcohol, or we focus on some of these, what do you want to say, big things. Well, God showed me anger. That can be a stronghold. Unforgiveness. Oh, man, if you can't let go, you are bound. And to move forward is very difficult. Unbelief. Unbelief was a big one. Unbelief. I have family. That unbelief is a big one. There was rebellion. There was self-sufficiency. There was disappointment. They were bound by disappointment, and they couldn't see further than that. They couldn't see that God was still on the throne. See, disappointment. And so, I know that most of you know this, but just so that you know, this is how I prayed. And I asked the Holy Spirit to show him when he would, I would take that particular thing, and I went into the high place. And I said, you spirit of anger, I pull you down in the name of Jesus. You'll not operate here anymore. Amen. You see, God tells us we can do that, and we can help set people free. Amen? In the mighty name of Jesus. And I want to tell you something. I saw God begin to work. It might be a little thing here, a little something spoke here, but I saw God begin to work. And you know what? He's still working. And I'm still praying. And I'm still pulling down, because it doesn't end. The enemy will always try to trap someone, hold them in bondage, keep them from being what God wants them to be. Amen. Amen. So the second thing, and this is where it may be hard, but the second thing that God gave me was our nation. There's a lot of things that we can pray about here. We know that. But God with me, God started with three. Actually, he started with one. And then he later brought in two more. And they all have to do with children. The first one, abortion. Second one, child sex trafficking. And child indoctrination. Yeah. Now, you know, we may not want to hear that this morning. But God's given it to me, so I'm going to speak it. Okay? So in 2 Kings, on these altars where we read earlier, that they had built, these altars that they built and were having sacrifices on, do you know that they were offering up their children? Their own children, they were offering on the altars, giving them, sacrificing them to a pagan god, Baal. Baal. That was his name. I want you to go to Jeremiah 19, 3 and 5. And say, hear the word of the Lord. Now, this is Judah. This is the kingdom of Judah that was doing this. Hear the word of the Lord, O kings of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring such a catastrophe on this place that whoever hears of it, his ears will tingle. Why? Because they have forsaken me. They have made this an alien place because they have burned incense in it to other gods. whom neither they, their fathers, nor the kings of Judah have known. And they have filled, listen to this, they have filled this place with the blood of innocents. They have also built the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings to Baal, which I did not command or speak, nor did it come into my mind. They burnt their children as a sacrifice to a pagan god. And we look and think, how could that even be? And today, babies by the thousands, every day, are being aborted. Even babies to full term, they're being aborted. The enemy has taken from us a generation. Babies, innocent blood poured out. And I believe that God is angry. Yes. Secondly, child trafficking. Children taken and sold for sex. You know, we can't even imagine the pain, the terror that they would even experience, and the very things that were done to these children. And for what? For man's entertainment. Yes. For his pleasure. Yes. For his sick perversion. Children are being taken and sold. God help us. And you know, it's like we say, is this really true? Is it really true? Well, let me ask you then, why, when your kids are out playing, do you not let them play too far? Why do you keep a good watch on them? That's why you're out in the crowd, you keep them close to you. Yeah, it's real. It's real. And I want to tell you something, and I think the Lord really used some of these things to wake me up, because I know that many of you don't, but I think some of us think we're in a bubble here in the valley. I think we think that, oh, that won't happen here, and we see it somewhere else. But it can be here. And we need to be alert. God, I believe God is angry. And child indoctrination. Oh, man. There is a system. There is a spiritual system. It's a demonic system. And it's trying to steal our children's identity. There are those that are asking our little ones, are you a boy? Are you a girl? Asking them, do you want to be a boy? Do you want to be a girl? Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Well, I tell you what. God says they're made in his image. And their identity comes from him. Not from someone wanting to fulfill their agenda. What they want. And who, I'm going to just ask, who are these gods that our children are being sacrificed to? Well, how about the god of money? The god of greed? The god of power and control? The god of lust? That these men bow down to, that they're held in control with. John 10:10 says, The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. God impressed upon me as I was doing this, because I kept thinking, oh, God, some of that's hard words, you know? It's just hard. And that God impressed upon me, the devil wants to take out a generation of our children. He wants to take them out. And it should make us mad. Mad enough to stand in the gap. Mad enough to begin to pray and to pull down the strongholds. Listen to me, it can be done. It can be done. And God's given us the answer in his word. He says, I want you to go to the high places. That's the answer. And that spiritual host of wickedness, you pull them down. Those strongholds. How? Through God-empowered prayer. You know, one of the things that the Lord showed me about myself, and then I'll be closing, but one of the things, you know, I've recognized that there's abortion. I've recognized the trafficking. I've recognized the indoctrination. And it's not that I didn't pray. But doing this, and God doing this with me and taking me to the verses, it's like he showed me that there were blinders. There were blinders. I saw, but I didn't really see. And see, the enemy wants to keep the church blind. He doesn't want us to really see. Yeah, we know, we hear. But to really see what's taking place, he doesn't want us to. So I just encourage you. I pray that you were challenged. I pray I didn't offend. You know, we don't want to offend. But I know that God wants it said. He wants us to wake up and stand in the gap and to pray and to see him move. I'm going to tell you something. God said to me, Karen, I am moving. Amen. Now partner with me. Yes. See, partner with me. And so this morning, if you're one that is struggling or in a fight and you realize there's some things that are holding you back, we got prayer people up here. So y'all come on, just come on up, because I want to give you the opportunity that if there's things in your life and you know that you are being held back, well, God has an answer for you. Amen? He has an answer for you. Or if you're here this morning and you have a loved one and you know without a doubt that the enemy has got them in their grip, his grip, well, we can pray for you and we can stand in agreement with you. We can stand in agreement with you that the strongholds come down and they're set free. I'm going to tell you, I know that there are times that we go through things a long time. I get that. I really do. I have seen some. But I don't think it should be every time. And I don't think it should be all the time. I think that there is that place that we can pray and we can come into agreement and we can see God work. I believe that. I believe that. And so I'm challenging you this morning. And if you have been challenged this morning, I just want you to know we need you. God needs you. God needs you to find that place. And if your eyes have been blinded, then come forth and let's pray that they get unblinded. Amen? Because that's what happened to me. It had to happen to me for me to feel the things that were taking place, not just hear about it, not just be told about it, but to feel it. And it become real. It become real to me.